Hello everyone, and welcome to the first episode of Matt's Movie Remarks. In this series, I'll be reviewing movies through a Marxist lens. My name is Matt Conley, and for this first review, we'll be taking a look at the 2013 film Snowpiercer, directed by Bong Joon-ho. If you haven't seen the film, I highly recommend checking it out, and because I'm going to be covering important plot details in this video, I'm issuing a spoiler alert here. Snowpiercer is set in a dystopian future in which Earth is experiencing its second ice age. The ice age is caused by a feeble attempt to stop global warming through stratospheric aerosol injection. The aerosol injection was supposed to cool the Earth's temperature by a few degrees, but it horribly backfired. 18 years after the beginning of the ice age, the only living members of Earth are all inhabitants of a train called Snowpiercer. The train is divided into three sections. At the tail end, we have the poorest members of the train. These passengers are the source of the train's free labor, but because the employment opportunities for these tail passengers are so limited, most are unemployed through no fault of their own. The middle section of the train is occupied by passengers who have more specialized occupations, essentially the professional managerial class. The front section of the train is home to its most elite residents. These passengers don't work, but rely on the labor of the back two sections for their livelihoods. The plot kicks off when the tail passengers, who are fed up with the abuse they've suffered at the hands of the guards who watch over them, begin a revolt. The revolt is led by the film's protagonist, Curtis, and his second-in-command, Edgar. The tail passengers overpower the guards and make it to the prison section of the train. Here they free Namgun Min-soo, a security specialist who designed the locks to the train's car doors. Nam agrees to help the tail passengers get to the engine on the condition that they free his daughter Yona and that they both get drugs made from hazardous waste called Kronol. After progressing through a few doors, the tail passengers find themselves face to face with the train's guards. The guards are directed by Wilford's cruel second-in-command, Minister Mason. Just as fighting begins, the train passes through a tunnel, leaving the tail passengers blind. The guards, equipped with night vision goggles, start picking off the helpless tail passengers one by one. The tail passengers are able to fight back using fire to light their way. Curtis captures Minister Mason, who calls for a ceasefire, but not before Edgar is fatally stabbed. The tail passengers rest for the night, and Curtis and Gilliam have a brief but important conversation. Gilliam is the de facto leader of the tail passengers and also a father figure to Curtis. Gilliam and Curtis discuss past revolutions conducted by the tail passengers, all of which have failed. Gilliam congratulates Curtis on leading the most successful revolution yet. However, Gilliam seems hesitant about continuing the revolution and asks Curtis if he wants to continue with his plan of capturing the engine. Curtis asserts that he does want to continue pushing forward, and the next morning he does just that. Curtis takes a small group of passengers, including Nam and Yona, a skilled fighter named Gray, and Tanya and Andrew, who are two parents looking for their children who were brought to the front of the train. The rest of the tail passengers stay back to guard the guards that were captured during the fighting. Curtis and his group reach the middle section of the train, where they see the relative opulence compared to their living situations. The group reaches a classroom, where they find a teacher sharing propaganda about the greatness of Wilford and the miracle that is his train. The teacher then shows a video which doubles as propaganda and an expositional history of the train. Snowpiercer was created by Wilford, who supposedly foresaw the climate crisis that would come from the aerosol injections. The train is powered by the Eternal Engine, which is essentially a perpetual motion machine to ensure that Snowpiercer never stops running. During this time, Tanya looks for her son Timmy, and Andrew looks for his son Andy, but they're nowhere to be found among the classroom's children. The train then passes by a famous landmark called the Revolt of the Seven. The teacher explains to the children that in the third year on the train, seven passengers escaped in an attempt to see if Earth was habitable. The seven only got about 50 yards before they all froze to death, and their bodies still remain preserved in the manner in which they died 15 years later. The teacher mocks the seven in front of the children and says that the traitors got what they deserved. Snowpiercer passes Yekaterina Bridge, which marks the 18th year that the train has been in operation. To mark the beginning of a new year, a servant brings boiled eggs to all the people in the classroom before bringing the eggs back to the tail passengers. A violinist begins to play music for the children in the classroom, and the tail passengers recognize him as Gerald, a man who used to be a tail passenger, but because of his skills was brought to the middle section of the train. Tanya notes how clean and well-fed Gerald looks, especially since the last time they saw him at the back of the train. As the servant reaches the tail section of the train, he pulls out a gun and begins shooting the tail passengers with bullets, which were originally thought to be extinct. The teacher pulls out a gun as well, and shoots Andrew in the head, killing him instantly. The skilled fighter Gray kills the teacher, and Curtis picks up her gun. The classroom TV switches to a live feed of the back of the train, where one of Minister Mason's guards, Franco, shoots and kills Gilliam. In retaliation, Curtis shoots and kills Minister Mason. Curtis's group continues to push forward through the train, but soon Franco catches up with them. Franco is able to kill Tanya and Gray before Curtis is able to kill Franco. Tanya's dying wish is that Curtis finds and takes care of her son Timmy. Curtis, Nam, and Yona make it to the final car before the engine. Here, Nam tells Curtis why he's been collecting so much Chronal. In addition to being a hallucinogenic drug, Chronal can also be used as an explosive. Nam tells Curtis that he wants to blow a hole in the side of the train so that they can escape, but Curtis stops him, saying that he wants to meet Wilford first. Wilford's assistant, Claude, opens the door to the engine room and shoots Nam. She then invites Curtis inside so that he can meet with Wilford. Wilford and Curtis begin talking, and Wilford reveals to Curtis that him and Gilliam have been working together to reduce the train's population. Wilford says that Gilliam wanted Curtis to start the revolution in order to kill as many people as possible so that the train's resources wouldn't be stretched too thin. At first, Curtis doesn't believe this, but Wilford shows him a phone that is connected to the tail end of the train. Wilford calls the tail end of the train, where his servant picks up. Wilford orders that 74% of the tail passengers be killed. Wilford then offers Curtis the position to be the conductor of the train. At first, Curtis is hesitant, but then it seems like he wants to accept the job after all. Just before he can accept, Yona rushes in and overpowers Claude. Yona lifts up a floor panel, where she finds a child working on the machinery of the engine. Curtis realizes that this is Timmy, Tanya's son, and rushes to help pull him out of the floor. Curtis eventually lifts Timmy out, but not before he loses his arm. Curtis realizes what he must do, and he gives Yona a match to light the fuse connected to the chrono. Curtis and Nam shield Yona and Timmy with their bodies as the explosion goes off. The explosion causes an avalanche that derails the train, killing everybody but Yona and Timmy. As Yona and Timmy walk out of the wreckage of the train, they spot a polar bear, indicating that life can exist outside of the train. The ending of the film is quite ambiguous, but overall I think the movie was very well done. Before I get into my two main interpretations of the film, I wanted to break down some Marxist concepts present in Snowpiercer. From the very beginning of the film, the class antagonisms present in Snowpiercer are quite apparent. At the back of the train are the poor masses who provide free labor to the relatively small wealthy elite group located at the front of the train. The background of the wealthy elite is not explicitly stated, but it can be assumed that these people were either capital owners before Earth's second ice age, or they have some sort of owning stake in Snowpiercer. Regardless of how each individual member of the wealthy elite got to their spot at the front of the train, they are no doubt beneficiaries of pre-existing capital garnered through exploitation of the working masses. In the few scenes where we see the wealthy front passengers, their activities are marked by labor-free lifestyles and day-long, drug-infused parties. The partygoers enjoy snorting Chronal, which is manufactured by the poor masses in the back of the train. Despite being the main source of labor for Snowpiercer, the tail passengers have little to no chance of upward economic mobility. This rings very true for our capitalist society today. It is your point of birth, rather than your work ethic, that is the biggest predictor of your economic outcomes as an adult. In the same vein, we can think of the train Snowpiercer as a closed capitalist system, with the eternal engine being the means of production. Curtis notes at the beginning of the film that the person who controls the engine essentially controls the world. Again, this is very reminiscent of capitalism as a whole, because the people who control the means of production have the most power in our society today. All of the train's passengers are met with a great deal of propaganda. Returning to the classroom scene, the teacher is indoctrinating the children into believing that Wilford's train Snowpiercer is the greatest thing that there is. There can be nothing outside of the train, and without the train, everyone would perish. If we look at this as an allegory for capitalism, the teacher is essentially telling the children that there's no other economic system that can exist or will work. American education functions very similar to this. American children are taught that capitalism is the only viable economic system, and that any other system trying to replace it, like socialism, will never work. As much as your conservative uncle may tell you that schools are indoctrinating kids into Marxism, this couldn't be further from the truth. Think tanks like the Heritage Foundation pump out school curriculum that preaches the wonders of the free market. The school children on Snowpiercer are essentially taught the same propaganda that American kids are exposed to daily. The tail passengers on Snowpiercer also receive their fair share of propaganda. Several times throughout the film, Minister Mason notes that everyone on the train has their preordained, particular position. Minister Mason does a great job here of manufacturing consent, essentially telling the tail passengers that there's no point in trying to better their situations. The repeated use of the line, preordained, particular position, is meant to uphold the oppressive structure of the train and tells the tail passengers to kind of know their place. Just in case the tail passengers don't already know their place, there's a squadron of heavily armed guards there to maintain the oppressive structure by force. The Snowpiercer guards act as any police force under capitalism, and work to maintain the interests of capital. If a tail passenger even questions the morality of the economic system, they are violently suppressed and made an example of. One such instance of this is when Andrew tries to protect his son Andy from doing slave labor at the front of the train. The guards seize Andrew and force him to hold his arm out of the train for 7 minutes until it is completely frozen. Then the guards break off his frozen arm with a hammer. This tells the tail passengers to keep their mouths shut, or they'll be met with the same violent torture that Andrew was met with. In addition to maintaining the capitalist system on the train through propaganda and force, the owning class also has another tool at their disposal. The owning class exploits the alienation felt by the tail passengers to make them feel as hopeless about improving their situation as possible. There are a few ways that alienation is experienced by the tail passengers throughout the film. One such instance occurs after the tail passengers make it through about 5 cars at the beginning of their revolution. Here they find Paul, a former tail passenger who was previously assumed to be dead. Paul has the grueling task of making the protein bars for the tail passengers to eat. Paul's job requires him to do the same motion every day. Paul has to grind up the bugs that the protein bars are made from, filter the bug mixture into a mold, and then cut the protein bars into little brick-like shapes. Paul shows clear signs of alienation from his work. First, he's alienated from his product because he doesn't get to choose what to produce, instead being directed by the capitalist elite to produce food for their source of labor. Paul's work is mechanical and repetitive, and it offers him no satisfaction as he has no ownership over the things that he's producing. Paul is also alienated from the other passengers. After Curtis and Tanya try to have a conversation with Paul, he just dismisses them as if they're not even there. He has become so disconnected and isolated from everyone else that he believes that they're just figments of his imagination. In a very real sense, Paul is alienated both from his surroundings and himself. The children from the tail section, especially Timmy and Andy, experience alienation in several ways as well. At the end of the film, the Eternal engine starts to malfunction and needs to be operated manually. Wilford calls for Andy, who climbs out of the bookcase where he had been living. Despite Curtis trying to stop him, Andy climbs into the engine, which moves back into the wall, and Andy is never to be seen again in the film. As this is happening, Yona forces her way into the engine room and overpowers Claude. Yona lifts up a floor panel where her and Curtis find Timmy. They see Timmy doing hard manual labor in a very confined space. Timmy was put in the floor to replace a gear that had broken. In a very literal sense, Timmy became a cog in the capitalist machine. Andy and Timmy both experienced alienation because they didn't decide on their own what to produce. In addition, they had to perform the same repetitive motions that left them with no ownership over what they were producing. Finally, both Andy and Timmy were alienated from others, as Andy was trapped in the engine and Timmy was stuck in the floor. After identifying some key Marxist concepts found within Snowpiercer, I want to get to my two interpretations from the film. I find that there's both a pessimistic reading of the film and an optimistic reading of the film. My pessimistic interpretation of Snowpiercer is that it promotes eco-fascism, which is the belief that, in order to stop climate change, totalitarian measures have to be taken to severely limit people's liberties, and in some cases advocates for the killing of certain groups of people to ensure that there are enough resources to go around. Do I believe that this was Bong Joon-ho's intent when he was creating the movie? No. I do not believe that Bong Joon-ho is an eco-fascist. However, there are many instances in the film where eco-fascism is promoted as a viable measure to ensure that the train does not become overpopulated. The first time eco-fascism is really promoted is when Curtis and Gilliam talk after the tunnel fight with the guards. Gilliam tells Curtis that he's led the most successful revolution to this point. There had been 3 previous revolutions, each of which had failed miserably, and resulted in the deaths of up to 70% of the tail passengers. Gilliam says this as if it pains him, but as we know by the end of the film, Gilliam and Wilford work together to reduce the train's population. Gilliam knowingly sent hundreds of people to their deaths just to ensure that the tail section had enough resources to go around. As the tail passengers make their way through the middle and front sections of the train, food is shown to be in abundance, indicating that the eco-fascist actions taken by Gilliam were unnecessary. We see this in our current, predominantly capitalist global system today. We produce enough food each year to feed the world 1.5 times over, yet 9 million people starve to death annually. This is because there's no profit incentive to feed hungry people who have no money to pay for food. This is the exact case for the tail passengers in Snowpiercer. They don't have enough money to incentivize the front sections to send them leftover food, leaving them destitute and hungry. When Curtis reaches the Eternal Engine, Wilford explains to him why killing hundreds of innocent people is necessary. Wilford describes Snowpiercer as a closed ecological system, and that because everyone on the train is in their preordained particular position, as Minister Mason says, it only makes sense that the poor people die so that the wealthier passengers can continue living their extravagant lifestyles. Curtis almost accepts Wilford's offer to be the train's new conductor. especially after believing that Gilliam and Wilford might be onto something. He snaps out of this thinking, though, after realizing that Timmy needs to be saved from the floor. Even after the revolutionaries rescue Timmy and blow a hole in the side of the train, there's one final scene where the film seems to suggest that ecofascism is a good solution to climate change. This is as Timmy and Yona are climbing from the wreckage of Snowpiercer. These two are the only ones shown to be alive after the train crashes. Immediately after this, Yona and Timmy see a bear, which indicates that life can exist outside of the train. But in order for that to happen, most of the Earth's population, represented by the Snowpiercer passengers, has to die off. Only then can Earth's climate change be reversed, and the human population can begin anew. As I said before, I don't believe that Bong Joon-ho is an eco-fascist, nor is that what he's trying to say in the film. However, I do see a lot of evidence that even a casual viewer of Snowpiercer could take this message away. My more optimistic take on the film is that Snowpiercer itself represents the capitalist realism mindset, and it also shows by the end of the movie how two characters are able to break away from this kind of thinking. Capitalist Realism is a 2009 book written by the late Mark Fisher. In this book, Fisher details his ideas of capitalist realism, which he describes as the widespread sense that not only is capitalism the only viable political and economic system, but also that it is now impossible even to imagine a coherent alternative to it. Most of the passengers on Snowpiercer are trapped in this kind of mindset, from Wilford to Minister Mason to even Gilliam and Curtis. Even before the revolution begins, Curtis says something to the effect of, "Whoever controls the engine controls the world." And as I've identified, the eternal engine represents capitalism. Therefore, Curtis's statement and his goal for the revolution is to not overthrow capitalism, but rather take over the economic system and reform it. We see evidence of this at the end of the film as well, when Wilford offers Curtis the position to be the conductor of the train. Curtis nearly accepts this position, even after witnessing the brutality of the capitalist engine firsthand. In this moment, Curtis can't fathom an economic system other than capitalism. He's fallen victim to the same propaganda that the children are exposed to in the classroom, and the propaganda that he's been subjected to his whole life. Minister Mason has been, for years, drilling into the heads of the tail passengers the dogmatic adherence to capitalism. She does this by saying that everyone has their preordained particular position in the train, reinforcing the idea that economic mobility is impossible. She also says throughout the film that the tail passengers should be grateful for their oppressors. She says that without Wilford, none of you would be alive. This point is very far from the truth. In fact, Wilford has been exploiting the tail passengers for many years. In the first few years of the train, the tail passengers even had to resort to cannibalism just to survive. The tail passengers literally had to give themselves to their friends. Gilliam and Curtis both cut off appendages that they gave to the starving masses so that they could eat. So just because Wilford built the train does not mean that the tail passengers have to be grateful to him. In fact, the tail passengers are alive in spite of Wilford. Regardless, this does not stop Minister Mason from preaching an almost religious-like devotion to trickle-down economics on the train. An interesting idea that Fisher brings up in Capitalist Realism is the idea that even anti-capitalist movements uphold the infrastructure of capitalism. Anti-capitalism can be branded and sold as a commodity rather than an actual ideological movement. This sentiment is proven by the three failed revolutions conducted by the tail passengers in the past. Gilliam, who was later revealed to be working with Wilford, sold the idea of anti-capitalism and revolution to the tail passengers in the past. He did this while knowing full well that the tail passengers would be executed before they even reached the middle section of the train. The anti-capitalist fervor felt by the tail passengers actually helped reinforce capitalism. This is because the revolutions acted as artificial selection, leading to the deaths of hundreds of innocent civilians, all to uphold the eco-fascist idea that there's not enough resources on the train, and therefore some passengers must die in order for the equal allocation of those resources to be upheld. Ecofascism works within the framework of capitalism very well, because it presupposes that capitalism is the only system that can efficiently allocate resources, even though the only true way to combat climate change is move away from the capitalist mode of production. By the end of the film, it is only Nam and Yona that come to this realization. It is Nam who is the real revolutionary, not Curtis. Curtis only wants to reform capitalism, which will still uphold the oppressive structure of the system. It is Nam and Yona who want to blow a hole in the side of the train to escape capitalism and find a new economic system. It is only after Curtis sees Timmy performing grueling child labor that he too comes to this realization. I think it's important to identify Nam as the true revolutionary in the story, because even though he's portrayed as a secondary main character, he's actually the real hero of the story. On my first viewing, I thought that Curtis was the real revolutionary because after all, he did lead the tail passengers in revolt against the oppressive police state they lived under. However, on my second viewing, I realized that Nam is the true hero because without him, a post-capitalist world could not be realized. My interpretation of the ending of Snowpiercer is more of an optimistic one. After Yona and Timmy emerge from the wreckage of Snowpiercer, they are greeted with a blank landscape. This fits right in line with Fisher's vision of capitalist realism because, as he says, it's impossible to even imagine a coherent alternative to capitalism. The blank landscape of the snow-covered mountains represents a post-capitalist society. We may not be able to quite envision what a post-capitalist society could look like, but at the same time, it's a blank canvas for us to create a better economic system than capitalism. After being liberated from the oppressive confines of the train, Yona and Timmy have the opportunity to create a more fair and just society. That's it for this first installment of Matt's Movie Remarks. Thank you for watching. Let me know down in the comments what other movies you'd like me to review, or let me know what you think about this video. I'd love to hear your takes on Snowpiercer, and whether or not you agree with my analysis. Don't forget to like and subscribe for more Marxist content. Thank you!